Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Muscle and Fitness Reps. My name is Don Saladino, and this is Zack Zeigler. Your name? Perfect. Zack is the chief editor of Muscle and Fitness, among many other public.
Yeah, you can tell me you just called me. Yeah.
I was going to say it. If you guys have any questions, please feel free to hit us up below with your comments and let us know how we can help out. But we are going to be discussing a lot of fitness and non-fitness related topics.
There's also an email address, which I forgot.
reps@muscleandfitness.com. And that was almost 2 minutes. So let's get going.
That was actually 1 minute and not even a minute.
Perfect. Boss, how was the Arnold, first off?
Are
we allowed to talk about that, or is that bad?
I think we could, but I mean, it'll be old news. Well, here's the thing. I didn't see any of the show. I saw maybe 5 seconds of it. So it was mostly like we were working on something specific, Daniel and Pierce mostly working on it, me just tagging in, and I just had a few specific things I had to take care of. But
did you see O'Hearn?
No. Wow. Didn't run into him.
Boo-hoo you, Mike.
Did talk to, we got a really good interview with Sean Ray.
Oh, yeah. Interesting.
Yeah. Really, really forthcoming guy.
I think he's he always seems like a very, like, articulate, very, like, animated.
Totally.
Boisterous.
Yeah.
Like, I've always thought he's pretty cool for the sport.
Very cool.
Yeah.
Does not, I love the fact that he doesn't hold back.
No.
You know, that's the best part about him, because a lot of people are very, they don't want to say what they really think because they're afraid that it's going to irritate somebody. He doesn't give a shit. He'll let it rip, and that's the best part about
it. What's his, and I know I don't want to get too off topic, sure. But what's his main, like, gripe? Like, there's specific things that he's probably just disgusted with in the sport, or what would that be?
We didn't talk about that. We actually spoke to him about when he was stripped of the Arnold Classic title. He failed a drug test. The 1 year that they tested, they took the title from him. And
holy shit, I didn't even know that.
Yeah. It's crazy.
That's ridiculous.
There's
never been someone who's won the Arnold who hasn't been on it.
Right. Yeah.
So how do you go and do that? That's the most ridiculous thing I've ever heard. Who ended up getting the title?
The Mike something or other, runner-up. I don't know. But yeah, basically, I guess.
Mike Matarazzo? I mean, who would have been?
No.
I
don't know who it was. The story he told, he said he'd never told it in depth like that before, which is
has
really
he
cool.
Has he won an event? I mean, he finished a lot of seconds, a lot of thirds.
He just never won the Mr. Olympia. But he won a lot.
He won
the year after.
Well, that's good.
So basically,
great physique, just wasn't that tall.
Yeah, but he won the year after. So basically, he did win 2 years in a row, but it was kind of like redemption. But he said it was one of the best things that happened for him because he really, like, ignited his,
Jesus.
funny word to use there. Don.
Actually, I didn't even know that. Thank you.
But yeah, he said it really did, like, kind of push him to get back in there and, like, want to win to prove that he was, you know, a winner. And
he was good.
Really, really cool interview. Really excited to show that footage. And the piece that our team here, Daniel and Pierce, are putting together at Muscle Fitness is going to be really, really cool. And I can't wait to see it.
I can't wait to see it. And that was a competitive, he was in a competitive era too. He had some really big names.
Exactly.
Was it Flex Wheeler, Kevin Lavroni, Chris Cormier? Ronnie was in that era also for a period of time, right? I mean, so was, Dorian Yates. I mean, they were all kind of crossing over, I think, in that time. So I thought that was pretty competitive.
That whole, yeah, it was, I mean, that whole era was insane.
Yeah, insane.
And, but yeah, he definitely had, he had a lot to say. And after that interview, I just came up with a huge list of stuff I want to talk to this guy about.
Well, we should bring him on.
Would love to. I'm trying to get him out here to New York. He lives in California. I really want to get him here. And the best part is he would not hold back if we had to ask him or wanted to ask him about his thoughts about the competitive landscape or where he thinks things are going right, going wrong. He'll just let us know, and that's cool.
You need more of that in the sport.
We do.
It's exciting.
We do.
It's exciting.
It also is, we do. We need less just people being, you know, hiding their opinions. I think it's good to get them out. We have people that'll do it on chat boards and, you know, people that'll just do it behind their computers, but he's a different character because he's been in it. So his opinion to me means it carries a lot more weight.
Well, it's also, I mean, he's pretty much through, I mean, I wouldn't even necessarily through the peak of his career in bodybuilding. I mean, obviously that's over. So he's not bodybuilding anymore, but I'm sure he's got other things going on in business. The problem with giving the truth is that things at times will come back to haunt you. And if he says something and then he's doing a deal with a brand or there's a comment that was passed 7 years ago, it comes back to haunt him. I mean, I don't blame certain people for wanting to, you know, put a little bit of restriction on what they're saying, but, you know.
But, okay, but like, has that ever happened to you?
I definitely think about what I mean, I think I'm pretty good at kind of pushing the line a little bit, you know, saying but there are, listen, if I ever said something about someone or voiced an honest opinion that I had of someone, like if there's someone in the industry that I, you know, dislike for whatever reason, I mean, that's my opinion. I should keep it to myself. I don't know.
Why should you keep it to yourself?
Well, because I don't really know how it's benefiting me by turning around and voicing how I feel about something.
Because you're a personality, though.
I am a personality, but I also, it's like, I need to worry about my business. I need to worry about my family. I need to worry about putting myself in situations that are going to put me better off, not actually hurt me. And I would rather me do really well in business and really do well with getting my message across in a positive way. Allow that to elevate me and where I am. I don't like when people have to elevate their own popularity by talking shit about other people.
I agree.
Now, have I ever gotten on and been disgusted about certain individuals that, you know, might be public right now and might have, you know, stolen from other people or have done specific things where I'm like, listen, if that's the truth, it's just disgusting. There should be a no tolerance policy. We have too many people in the industry who really need to even, well, we don't need to put up with that crap. So yeah, I'll voice my opinion about that. But you know, if I feel someone is doing something completely wrong or they're a fraud in the industry, yeah, maybe I should open my mouth and speak about it. I don't know. I really have mixed feelings about it.
See, I could see if you were asked something specific or personal about one of your celebrity clients where you'd want to stay tight.
Oh, yeah, that I would never.
That to me would affect business. But when you're asked, you know, we talk about it a lot, how to police the all the bullshit that goes on in the industry and a lot of the misinformation. I think it does take guys like you and the knowledgeable people that have spent their lives trying to get that misinformation out of the way. And when it creeps in, it does take people like you to stand up and throw the flag and say, by the way, that right there is horseshit. I don't think you're necessarily being rude to somebody by saying...
It's fair enough. No, I think you got some valid points on that, and it is noted, and, you know... Do I voice my opinion? Yes. I just think there's a way to do it.
But there's all, you know, it's also weird because when you do, even if you don't, I noticed the other day, and I don't know if we talked about this, maybe we did, but you were on social media asking somebody a question, and it was an innocent question. And I think you were really genuinely asking about how a specific move was going to help somebody. And then
I kind of knew the answer to it, though. So in all fairness, and this is me being honest, I saw someone doing something that I would do a little differently. So, yeah, I would say I very politely challenged the person.
Right.
I didn't say that's wrong, this and that. I'd say, why are you doing it this way?
Yeah.
I wanted to get a response. And instead of that, I didn't even know about, and we call them trolls, people who just are on social media to comment and to start, you know, arguments. I don't even respond to that. But I don't even think I got a response from the individual, but you know.
Right. But here's the thing. I think the difference being if there was an explanation that made sense, I don't think you would have been like, well, you're still wrong. If it made sense to you, I feel like you'd have been big enough to be like, wow, cool, thanks.
Listen,
or whatever.
I had a client years ago who came to me and said that he knows what he needs to be working on. And he understands the direction I'm going to put him in because he definitely needed a decent level of corrective exercise and his fitness was a little off and he just, you know, was focusing on hypertrophy, but he had so much pain and there were so many issues. So, you know, he basically said, listen, I know what I need. I know what you're going to tell me, but I'm not going to do it. So I at least came up with a compromise with him and said, all right, listen, just give me 10 minutes of this warm up. Let's at least focus on that. And then I'll focus the other 45, 50 minutes on giving you what you want. And we still saw progress on it. Now, could someone look at me and say, oh, that's the wrong approach? Yeah, I mean, for optimization, to get that individual optimal in the areas of movement, quality, et cetera. But a lot of this stuff comes down to enjoyment also. If someone's enjoying CrossFit or if they're enjoying a specific style of training and they understand there's a cost to doing business, powerlifters, I mean, yeah, powerlifters, their job is to lift as heavy a weight from point A to point B. You're trying to tell me they're not in pain? You're trying to tell me they're not going to have movement issues, or the majority of them are going to have movement? The majority of them will, because they don't. A lot of them don't understand how to prepare for those lifts, or understand about waving on and off specific training blocks, or, you know, if they're living in a specific, their job is just to move as much weight as possible. So they're saying to themselves, no, I accept the fact I'm going to be in pain,
yeah,
but I'm not going to stop doing the thing that I love to do. Who was it? Jim Stepani. It was the movie Generation Iron. I remember it was the first one. I think they asked a bunch of Olympians, and I'm sure you heard this, if you were guaranteed a gold medal but knew you were going to be dead in 5 years, how many of you would take that? And 55% of them said they would. You know, and his point was, and I get it, he's like, this is what they do.
Yeah.
This is what they've trained for their whole life. This is what they believe in them. This is what makes them up as a human being. Like, do you think you're going to change their way of thinking? And I sat there and I thought about it and I laughed. And I'm like, wait a second, this is what defines them as a person. Part of what defines me as a person is my family, but it's also what I do for a living. So, you know, you love what you love, and you gotta hold on to that. You know, it's, I get it.
Did you see, speaking of powerlifters and strong people, did you see Hafþór?
Oh, yeah. I saw, wait, what did he pull? Like 1080?
I don't know the exact number, but it was.
I was more thinking about Stefi Cohen.
Yeah.
I thought that was almost more impressive because.
I was going to mention her, but starting with him, but like, it just seems to me, I mean, where do you go from here, right? So is he maxed out? Are these people maxed out?
I don't think we max the human body. I think records are made to be broken. There's a few records out there that will never be broken. Like, you know, Cy Young's, you know, win record of whatever he has, 500 something wins. You know, there's just certain records that pitchers will never come close to because they're cutting back on the volume of pitching. And like specific records, but I think if a guy's going to deadlift 1,100 pounds, someone's going to come lift 1,103 pounds. It's just those records are going to be broken. I think the human body, there's a lot we can do with it. And especially with drugs nowadays and with doctors and ratios, and I think them learning more about the body's chemistry and not just going in there and heavy, heavy, heavy all the time. I think learning how to train properly and actually training through science. But you see some strong people. Stefi Cohen, I mean, I never heard of this woman until a couple months ago. And, you know, they said she set an unofficial world record by like 11 pounds on the squat.
Yeah.
It's a good squat, man. But for a woman to turn around and for anyone, I mean, I'm not squatting 500 pounds right now. I mean, I have, but this second, no freaking way. You know, but that's unbelievable. Like, yeah. Women are squatting more than men now. It's incredible. Things that we never saw in the past are seeing now, and I think it's great. What do you think about it?
About what?
About records being made to be broken, meant to be broken.
I think about how even, I guess what? So I don't know how tall Hafþór is, right? But I think about him, if he's breaking that record, and I'll just use him as an example. How much more can you really pull from the ground? And how much bigger? I mean, is he tapped out? And how much bigger does somebody have to be? And genetically, what has to be toyed with for us to get to that point where that is going to be, that record is going to be like old news? Like, that's where I get to. Like, I look at that and I'm like, holy shit, that guy is a human being just like me. And I stand next to him and I'm like, how is this real? Like, it's crazy. I seem like a little kid. You know what I mean? Like, I'm looking at this dude and he is like a human, but he's also kind of not, you know, he's kind of like a giant.
Oh, he's huge.
Yeah. And he's huge. It just, to me, I'm like, how much bigger or stronger can we get, I guess? And is it just going to be, I don't know, man. It just, that's what I thought about. And I wasn't like, I was trying to think, I spaced out and thought of that. I was like, Where do we go from here?
The funny thing with powerlifting is that you really, like, it's not, these numbers aren't set after a year or two of training. It's like, these guys are like progressively overloading their body with heavy weight for you know, decades, whatever it might be. Like, there's this muscle maturity that just takes time. You see a guy, you know, it was funny. I was listening to a guy in my industry that I think pulled like 680 the other day, and he passed a really intelligent comment. He's like, you know, my quest for 700 is approaching. I might be about a year and a half though. And when I heard that, I thought, I was like, you know, wow, it's just a reminder that in the beginning, if you're a newbie, your weights are going through the roof. When you have established muscle and you and your training age is, you know, older, meaning you've been training 15, 20 years, those gains are going to be less and less.
Right. And you have to have more patience. Yeah, that's the thing. You have to have more patience, and you have to also understand that. And I think now with a lot of the information that's available, people are going to be more patient. But yeah, I can't imagine if they didn't have that, especially with all the technology they have to monitor everything, like, you know, even measure exactly how much they're taking of. And I don't know if this, I don't know, I'm not going to sit here and make any accusations about people, and I don't really care either way, but it's just, yeah, it was just crazy, and it just made me think for a second. And then,
well, you don't care. You know, you always say that you don't care about it.
I don't.
I know you don't, and I genuinely believe that you don't. What I care about, I don't care if a guy or a woman takes it to compete when the whole field is taking it.
Right.
I'm like, all right, listen, it'd be unfair if you didn't take it. Like, if you're competing in the Olympia and you're on stage against 16 guys and you're the only guy not taking it, like, all right, you're going to lose. Now, if you're going to compete for the, you know, attitude of morally, I feel it's wrong and I'm going to go finish last, but I'm going to still be on that seat, then great, more power to you.
Yeah, that's a waste of time.
The problem, yeah, but basically it is a waste of time, which is why I could never do it.
Me
because
neither.
I'm not willing to take it. The problem that I have is when you have a lot of these coaches who've only trained athletes or themselves, you can call it under the influence of performance enhancing drugs. You really could say under the influence. Under their body has been manipulated through growth hormone, testosterone, some type of steroid. I don't know enough about it, but you know, when you're trying to give advice to, you know, young kids out there, 16, 17, 18, I'm about to say 16, 17, 18, but it's the same advice you're giving to someone who's under performance enhancing drugs. There is argument whether, you know, you can give advice to someone who's natural if this is, you've only been working with people who's, like, there is argument there.
No, that makes sense. I think the only time it does bother me is when someone is in a category that's considered natural or whatever. Like, they're not going to get on that stage to be last. So they take a different route, and then somebody else does the opposite. Somebody else tries to sneak in, knowing that they're not falling. Then that bothers me.
Right.
And there was somebody that I know that when it was CrossFit Games, whatever their big, was it CrossFit? No. It might have been Tough Mudder X maybe. And she was trying out, and she was like, and she trains hard. I mean, she's freaking amazing. She's hardcore. And she was like, there was no way. I could not compete with these people. They were machines. Like, and she's not on anything. And she knew right away that she didn't stand a chance. And it was really disheartening to her because she trained her ass off and showed up. And I guess, I don't know if it's naively or just you don't think that it infiltrates everything. But yeah, she shows up there and people are just not needing any time to recover. They're just going nonstop, balls to the wall, hair on fire, 90 miles an hour for hours straight. And yeah, then I could also, you know, be upset too, because it's like, well, shit. But also, is it her fault for not knowing, or is it just...
No, I think general population isn't going to know. I mean, when you have someone turning around and watching an actor in Hollywood, and listen, all as far as I know, all of them I've worked with have never taken anything. I mean,
do you think The Rock is on juice?
Do I think he's ever taken anything?
Yeah.
I do.
I'm gonna tell him.
Go ahead. I mean,
I never talked to him.
No, but I mean, it's fine if you want. And if I'm wrong, then more power to him. I mean, I always say, you know, man's innocent. That's why I almost stuttered when you asked me that question. I'm like, how is he gonna? But yeah, I mean, if you wanted me to, listen, I've had people tell me that they thought I was on it. So I don't look at that as something offensive. He should hear that comment from me, and if he ever knew who I was, and he would say, "Well, all right, I'm not on it." And wow, that's a great compliment. Thank you.
Thanks, Don.
Yeah, thanks, Don. Like, I really appreciate it. Like, I did this naturally, and which is basically my answer also. But yeah, no, I mean, I've seen at specific ages people really blow up for certain roles pretty quickly. I've seen vascularity or change. I've seen almost a little bit of a purpleness in their skin. Almost how sweat's beating off their skin a little bit. It just, it looks, it smells different. Like, if you've been around it and you've seen people in gyms, like, you can tell.
Yeah.
So, to each his own. I mean,
that purple skin.
Yeah, no. You know what I'm talking
really
about.
Really turn on Grimace if you went to the local McDonald's.
Grimace? Who's that? You know all these, like, little characters. Grimace is always the cartoon character.
I guess Barney would be another one.
I know Barney.
Okay.
I love Barney.
Yeah, he's... He's purplish.
Who's your favorite cartoon character?
I don't know if I have a favorite character. I have many. but I did like, when I was younger, DuckTales. That was
a
big
DuckTales
one.
DuckTales wasn't my favorite, though.
No? I also liked, I liked that whole block, that Disney Afternoon, which you're probably not familiar with. Of course not. Too good for
no,
it.
I know. I was into, like, Roadrunner and the Wile E. Coyote. And,
yeah, I watched that.
Yeah, I like them.
Yeah. But I also then would watch, Saved by the Bell or Family Matters Step by Step. I would also, TGIF, anything of those. So it didn't have to be cartoons. but I also liked Beavis and Butthead, yeah. South Park, obviously, as I got older. And, but yeah, it's like, are you just not tapped into pop culture at all?
No, man. I was watching, like, Good Times and Sanford and Son, and I was watching all the stuff that they took off
the
air.
You're 41?
I'm 41, yeah, but I was watching stuff that was even a little bit beyond. I was watching, like, The Jeffersons. And I was literally in bed by myself watching TV laughing.
All in the Family?
I didn't watch All in the Family
See,
much.
I watched All in the Family.
I didn't watch All in the Family much.
Married with Children?
I did watch Married with Children. That was funny. That was really funny.
Yeah.
Christina Applegate was hot, too. See? I don't know how she looked now. She's probably still as hot.
I don't know. I'm not really sure.
Back to talk.
I was a big, what was his name? Grandmaster B?
Who's that?
Bud Bundy's, like, alter ego, the rapper? No?
No, I know who you're talking about.
Did you like Steve or Jefferson as the neighbor?
Oh, I don't remember.
See? You didn't really like the show. Why don't you just admit it?
No, I liked the show.
Mm. Okay.
I'm trying to think what I was really watching. I was watching, like, The Larry Sanders Show.
Yeah, I watched that.
That was funny. Say hey, Hank Kingsley.
Hey now.
Hey now. He's my favorite.
Yeah, here's the thing. I watched a ton of TV. Didn't really read a lot. Ton of TV. My friends, too. Like, didn't really... We played a lot of video games, a lot of, like, Super Nintendo, Genesis, Nintendo.
I missed Nintendo.
Not a lot of reading. Did you have Atari?
I did have Atari. I loved the first Nintendo with... Zelda and Super Mario Brothers. I got into Sega. Sega was fun.
Yeah. So you say Mario, I say Mario.
Mario. Yeah. I got into Lynx. Remember the little handheld?
Yes.
Lynx. I love that. I remember one Christmas I got Lynx and I was, like, flipping out over it. That was a really cool system too.
Yeah.
It was just fun how, like,
I had the Game Boy and then a Game Gear.
Yeah, I remember Game Gear. I had Game Gear.
Yeah. Actually, my buddy had the Game Gear.
I had Game Boy and Game Gear.
Yeah. And then they had the Game Boy Color, but it's like,
I don't know about that.
It's like, I can't be shelling out for that after I have the old black
and
white.
Remember Tetris? On Game Boy?
Yes.
Yeah, I love Tetris.
I used to play it for hours. In fact, when I was in high school, we used to go to my buddy's garage and play Dr. Mario for hours.
Play Dr. Mario much.
It was awesome. Still. Time of our lives.
It was good. I miss those game systems. I might buy one now.
You could buy the classic.
That's what I'll buy.
Yeah?
Mike Tyson's Punch-Out, I loved.
Do you know what they called it after that? After he had the rape accusation or rape, he was guilty. Found
punch
guilty.
Out.
So
punch out.
Yeah. All right. Change the punch. Whatever. Who was the end guy? Mr. Dream.
You're right. It was.
Thank you.
I started thinking of all the names like Don Flamenco and Soda Popinski and Bald Bull and.
Yeah. The weird thing is, some of them would show up twice.
Yeah. Wait. You would see
one
show up twice, but he was almost like he was just better, wasn't he?
Yeah. They were just. Yeah. It was.
Savage.
Especially Bald Bull. He would just get in the crouch position and then, like...
I bet Bald Bull was on testosterone.
I think so. Look at the size of his head.
Don Flamenco wasn't, though.
He's like, it was serious bison head going on. Yeah, I know. Well, the second time around, though, at least he had some balls to him. He was, like, had some fight to him, you know?
Didn't he have that, like...
Yeah. Yeah.
Want to kick his ass.
You remember the first guy you'd face off?
Yeah, I do. Oh, man. Give me his name.
Glass Joe.
Glass Joe. Yeah. Well, I know I'm a little slow. I'll get good with it.
Talk about taking a left turn. Who even knows? Like, who knows what we even just talked about? Look, it's getting warmer. I say that it's 27 degrees out right now.
It's not getting warmer.
It's not getting warmer.
Froze my ass off. But in theory, it's going to get warmer.
Right. I hope.
Yeah.
Although,
it will.
I hope so. I hope the sun rises tomorrow. And
It will get warmer.
All right. So the thing is this. We do get this question a lot, and people want to know. What do you think the question is? I already told you. Let's see if you remember.
It's getting warmer? Golf season?
Ah, no. We're not there yet, but we will talk about that. Okay.
It's getting warmer? I don't know.
Okay. A lot of people dust off the old running shoes, and Ooh. They want to get outside, get rid of that cabin fever. Let's talk about the differences between running on a treadmill or running outside, pros and cons, and yeah, so.
All right, so I'll definitely lead off with this. The pro to running on the running on a treadmill is, in my opinion, is just that you're running. I mean, it's the powered treadmill, the treadmill that you like plug in and you can set the speed.
The standard one.
The standard treadmill. It really I really believe it's not the greatest thing for you. I mean, running outside, you've got to actually use the ground force and you got to literally, you know, strike the ground and you got to pull using your posterior chain and you got. The regular treadmill, a lot of times what happens is we get these belts going, and I see it with a lot of guys, especially doing HIIT training, but they're setting the speed so high that when they're on it, they almost look out of control, and it's just putting them into like this excessive extension. So what's happening is their foot's grabbing that belt, and it's ripping it back. Like you run onto a belt, what's happening? Your leg's just getting snapped back, and it's throwing you into extension. And that's why you see a lot of these runners after running on treadmills are always like, my back hurts, my hips tight, my back hurts, my hips tight, which is why I've been using these powerless treadmills now where you have to strike the belt at a specific point and actually pull. And you'll feel like, I've been feeling like my clients, even myself, my hips are a lot looser. Sometimes my glutes are even getting sore from running inside.
Well, they look better.
Thank you very much. But that's, in my opinion, what's the benefit of running on a regular treadmill? I mean, you're getting your heart rate up and you're still getting work and you're still breaking a sweat and you're still doing something. It's better than nothing. But, I don't know, at a certain point.
And also getting outside, it's good to get some vitamin D. It's good for your mental health. You know, getting outside has been proven to help you just feel better, release tension, release anger.
Yeah.
And, you know, I can see on a treadmill when if it's at night or inclement weather or if you're in, you know, traveling and you're in a neighborhood you don't really know and you don't feel safe.
Get dangerous. Yeah,
yeah,
absolutely.
So I get it.
These are great points. These are great points.
I get it. But it's overall, it's like, if I can get outside, if it's an excuse to get outside, even if it's just a 10-minute jog or whatever, I get out there. But yeah, I've been using the self-powered treadmills too. And, you know, something you talked about too, it definitely has helped loosen my hips up. And I just feel more natural when I'm running on it, like opposed to now I really feel it. Because through the winter, I've been running on that. And recently I went on a regular treadmill and it was very uncomfortable. And it didn't feel right. But I also, you know, I don't know what, if it's a preference thing, but if I'm going to run on grass or asphalt, I'm choosing asphalt because I can see usually if there's a pothole or something like that in grass, as much as it might be a little bit of a, might be better for my joints and it might be a little softer. You know, I don't want to hit a hole or something, a divot and take a tunnel.
Oh, no, I completely understand. I mean, when I do like running on grass is during the summertime when if I'm doing some sprint work or I'm doing some shorter distances where I can get barefooted and really kind of, you know, they call it earthing. You can really feel the ground and the energy of the ground and, you know, just, you know, there's so many studies out there showing the benefits of being barefooted on the grass, which is a totally different topic.
Which I want to get into at some point.
Yeah, definitely.
Because I know that, you know, you're big on that. But
good stuff.
People that bench press a lot and sometimes have shoulder issues and... Is that natural? Is that something that you become? What is it that you're going to, granted, it could be because of a lot of things, but what's one of the first steps you're going to take to fixing it? And what are some of the things that contribute to this?
Well, first things first, if someone's having a shoulder issue, I am 10 out of 10 times sending them to one of my physical therapists to get assessed, maybe get some tissue work done, and to find out whether, if he or she continues to do this, is it going to cause more damage? And why would I ever have someone continue it if, you know, if they're training for a bench press competition, or if they you don't even necessarily need to bench press
to get a bench stronger.
So, you know, I'm always a believer, like, if you're feeling pain, no matter what it is, you can work around it.
I think that's an important point. Why did the bench press become such a staple for
training?
Just
a feat of strength. It was a very quantifiable measure for people to test strength, you know, and for years it was, you know, how much you bench. Then it became, you know, if you're asking how much you bench, it's almost a joke now. Why don't you ask me how much I squat or how much I deadlift? Which, yeah, I mean, listen, the three big lifts in a powerlifting meet are bench, squat, deadlift. So these are ways that people can quantify, you know, how strong they are. But there's so many other ways to quantify it.
I mean, is it sometimes too, like, you know, I know we're talking generically because we don't know the specifics of whatever person A here that's got a hurt shoulder, but is it to, maybe it has to do with their form? Maybe their shoulder, their elbows are flaring out and they're putting too much pressure. Maybe they're going
There are people I've seen for 30 years who benched, or I know that are older than me and have great bench presses, and they bench press incorrectly and they've never had a shoulder issue or an elbow issue.
Yeah.
You know, so it's just because someone's doing something incorrectly doesn't guarantee that they're going to be in pain. Now, the evidence would lead me to believe that they're probably going to develop some issues, but the human body's funny. Like you can do there's just certain movements that you can get someone to do correctly where they're like, oh, my elbow's flaring up and my tendonitis or whatever it might be. So, you know, I always believe in having sound technique. I always believe that there's an efficient way to lift a weight or to perform something. And to me, strength is a skill. So, you know, be very skillful and very mindful of how you're performing that lift. And if you're doing it correctly, you should reduce the risk of injury. Now, if your body is not set up to be able to perform those movements due to injuries or inefficiencies in movement patterns, yes, you should be picking a better, you should be selecting a better exercise to go train.
See, what I've done in the past, and when I've continued to bench press, even with injured shoulders, I've had shoulder injuries, is just I've either switched up my grip, using a more neutral grip, or gone to dumbbells. Just really moved away from the fixed position of a barbell on a flat bench.
Right.
And it helped. It helped immediately. But at the same time, I started to think, do I even really need a bench press in my life? When am I going to use it?
General Pop doesn't.
No.
They don't need it. I mean, I was doing floor presses yesterday. Yeah. And I love the floor press, and it's a very safe movement, and it's a little bit. But yeah, I mean, I have healthy shoulders, knock on wood, so I can train, you know, different exercises. But if you are injured and your doctor has given you permission to train, find what doesn't hurt and train it.
You know, it's another thing when I was, you know, when you're training for a sport like football, using a hammer strength to actually like get behind it and push out makes
sense.
Like
a because jammer, like one of those jammers are great.
Because you're going to be creating separation. That makes sense. But now, I don't really need that.
Right.
I don't really try to create separation or get into conflicts with people if I can help it.
Right.
And if I do, I just run.
Right,
because,
sure. But you're also very content with the way you train, and you're very content with how you feel. And for me, that's a good enough answer. So the reality is that your body's healthy, you look good, and you feel great, and it's working doing what you're doing. So my advice to you would be to continue doing what you're doing. I mean, it's not, we don't have to reinvent the wheel. Now, if someone was bored or they were hurt, then yes, we have to find a different approach, but you're great.
I know. Tell me more. All right, we got a question from someone in the audience about their one rep max. And I thought it was a good one, so I'm going to bring
it up. Do you ever one rep max?
No.
When's the last time that you have?
I can't even remember, to be honest with you. Years. It's maybe the last time I one rep max was in college, 20.
Interesting.
20. I don't even know. Long time ago. I'm going to date myself. But the question was, why should I care about it if I'm not in a weightlifting competition? And what's the benefit of doing it?
In my opinion, you don't ever need it.
Yeah.
I mean, even a power lifter, if they're they should be one rep maxing in competition. I think they should be cutting down on the risk of injury, or, you know, they're getting under incredibly heavy loads, or, you know, if there's a show they're competing in, fine, you can go for it and let it all hang out. But I mean, I've one rep maxed a bunch in my life, and I can tell you every time it's completely unnecessary.
Yeah, but you've done it with like, didn't you do it not too long ago, maybe a year or two ago, with a trap bar, like a trap bar deadlift?
No, I did it with a conventional deadlift, and it was just, I won't even know if it was a true 1RM though.
Yeah.
Like, it's the heaviest I went up to. I think I went up to like 560 on the conventional, and then that was, I still think I had more. Like when I looked at the bar come up, like I think I could have went for another. I could have went for another lift.
Yeah.
I just didn't. I was like, all right, no, it's fine. I felt good. It took a lot out of me, and I didn't want to go repeat it. I don't, even when I'm one rep maxing, I don't like things ever falling apart. I don't like looking at my set on camera because I'm always filming it if I ever did do a 1RM, and I don't like looking at it and saying, oh, that looks like shit.
But like for, you know, somebody that's just training, they don't need to go heavy. The idea of going heavier and heavier and heavier, or just to get this number and then try to beat it, I feel like it could be a recipe for injury.
It could be. I mean, if you are going to hit singles, I would make sure that you have some gas in the tank where you want to get under some load. So, like, your single can be, like, 99% or 98%. Like, just something short where you know you're going to get it, but you're like, wow, I haven't lifted that heavy in a while.
Sure.
I think it's a great confidence booster.
Yeah.
Like getting under heavier loads.
You're proving you're getting stronger.
Absolutely.
And you're proving it to yourself that what you're doing is working. But, you know, to try to just hit some arbitrary number just to say you did it or just to show people on social media that you're stronger than somebody else. I don't know. I don't know why you do it, but
a lot can get accomplished with doubles and triples and fives.
Yeah.
Like it's a lot. I mean, you can go in there and hit triples and get crazy, crazy strong. And I think for someone trying to get stronger, they should always leave a little gas in the tank.
Mm-hmm.
Jim Wendler talks about that a lot. Who's a really interesting guy. I'd love to have him on one day because he was an elite FTS guy, created the 5-3-1 program. And I thought, like, when you look at the simplicity of his training, like, I love it. I think it makes sense. If there's an advanced trainee who wants to get on a program, I would tell him to do 5-3-1. If there's a beginner that wants to get on a program, I tell him 5-3-1. It's just a really good basic program, but basic works.
Yeah.
And he everything he runs off of percentages, it's never off of a one rep max.
Right.
He's always taking, take 85% of your 1RM, and that's your 1RM number. And it's just slow and steady wins the race.
It's also, I think, if you're paying attention to how, you know, your progression, that can be enough.
Agree. Right. Totally agree. And we're on the same page.
We got another question. It's about the Smith machine. Somebody is asking if they should use the Smith machine or if they should use free weights.
I never saw you use. I mean, that's not something I never thought you'd be into.
Really. I'm not into it. I don't really use it. If anything, sometimes I'll use it to do a reverse pull up. I don't know what somebody else probably has another
inverted
name for
row.
Inverted row.
Inverted row.
Yeah,
no,
I mean,
it's great.
Really, whatever you want to call it. But like, you know, if you're doing, if I'm going to squat, I'm going to squat.
So
And because I'm going to be recruiting more muscle fibers, it's a more natural way for me to move. I feel kind of stifled in the Smith machine. I just prefer not to use it.
Right. I mean, I can break down some pros and cons to it.
Yeah.
I think. I mean, listen, years ago when I was rehabbing a hip that I messed up a little bit, I remember not being able to back squat, but I didn't even need to Smith machine squat. I could have went to a goblet squat. I could have went to a double kettlebell squat.
Right.
I could have went to a trap bar deadlift. It would have changed the angle up a little bit, but just getting that bar on my back, I remember doing it a couple times. It felt good. I was pain-free, and then I progressed off of that. Sometimes I wouldn't even recommend someone doing that, though. I think that with a lot of newbies out there, sometimes when they're getting under free weight by themselves, it's a little nerve-wracking.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it was something that I learned 21 years ago when I first got my first certification as a coach. They actually did recommend back then that a beginner would work off of machines. And it's something you never really hear anyone talk about nowadays.
Yeah.
But if you think about it, they're like, well, you don't have that neuromuscular coordination. You don't have that ability to balance early on because you're such a newbie and you have no training age. So at least start learning the pattern and at least start learning what that bar path is supposed to feel like and develop some muscular endurance early on. And I think if you're going to do that for a short period of time, like a week or two, and just to get kind of comfortable, I don't think there's any real downfall to that. I would still get the free weights as quickly as possible. But I know for bodybuilders sometimes when they're exhausted, wanting to get a pump, you know, getting on something that's a little bit, you know, that's on a track and that's guided so they can rush as much blood into the muscle as possible. I mean, these are tools for the trade, but not something I ever use or recommend people use.
Yeah, and plus, here's one stat. It's an 09 study from the Journal of Strength and Conditioning Research. So squats performed with free weights elicited 43% higher muscle activity than those performed in a Smith machine. I mean, it's just one of probably a trillion studies, but like that right there is enough for me. Like you said, if I'm going to switch it up, I'm going to jump to do some kettlebells. I'm going to do some like a trap bar. I'm not going to That's a last resort. If everything's taken and that's open, sure, I'll walk over to it. But I don't see any real benefit for me at this point. Again, maybe as a beginner, if you're just establishing it, but I I have no real reason to stop there.
I couldn't agree with you anymore. Now, I've got friends of mine, colleagues that are incredibly smart individuals that will turn around and say, the Smith machine's the biggest piece of garbage you're going to get on. I'm a little more lenient on that because if you are training with free weights 99% of the year and once in a while you want to jump on a Smith machine because it's just fun and it's getting you out of the monotony of it, then so be it. But just don't base the majority of your training around it. I think you're making a big mistake.
All right, that's it. Reps episode number 500, although only like
we've only had
four
two
of like Aaron. Yeah. shows how long we've been trying to perfect
this. Been doing this a while.
We have.
I think we're almost seasoned veterans at this point.
We're getting there.
I'm feeling very good about it.
Yeah, I'm less shitty than I was last time.
No, you're not.
Still horrendous. but look, email us, reps@muscleandfitness.com. Leave us a comment on YouTube. You can leave it on Facebook. You can also go to @DonSaladino Instagram. He's also on Playbook. It's an app available on... it's all Android now, too, right?
Android and iOS. And guys, wow us.
Yeah.
Wow us. Wow Zach us. And I want to be wowed. Pass some good questions. I mean, wow if you are really wowing us, then we may even select a guest one day. Who knows? I think it could be fun. So just, but bring up some questions that you might have, and we will definitely answer them.
Yeah. You can stay at Don's house. And
the address is.
Yeah. You could. We were told to remind you to like and subscribe, although I hate when people do that, but I'll comply.
Yeah.
And you got to turn on that notifications thing.
Yeah, push notifications.
I just did that. So that's how lazy I am. I just did it for our own thing.
You're on Instagram?
No. No, I meant for YouTube.
Oh, okay. Sorry.
No. I post like once every 5 months on Instagram.
You post more.
@ZRez.
You've got good content.
Anyway.
Guys, till next time. Remember, ask questions, and we'll see you soon.
Thanks. See ya.